General Orders Number 6269. For heroism while participating in aerial flight as evidenced by voluntary actions above and beyond the call of duty in the Republic of Vietnam, in the location of Hep Doc and other locations in and around the area of Chu Lai. Having survived for the 18-month period beginning June 1969 and ending December 1970. You have been sentenced to live. To live until the end of your natural life.
Wait a minute. You can't do that. Wait a minute. It's not fair. Those others, Jim, Mo, Johnny, all those others, they didn't get this sentence. It's not fair. They don't. You're not the judge and jury. I'll fix you. Look, I smoke these. I drink. I drive too fast. I do drugs. You can't sentence me to live. I control that. At least that. I know. I'll re-enlist. That's it. I'll re-enlist. Go back to where I belong. So fuck you. Fuck you! Fuck you! I'll re-enlist. I'll re-enlist. Oh. Those first few years back were pretty crazy. My mind's not real clear about all that went on. What with the drinking and the drugs, it's amazing I remember anything. I do remember that less than a week after shaking hands with my dad at the airport, I was in a car with the family, driving to Florida to spend Christmas vacation with Grandma and Grandpa. Oh, Christ, what a rich sight that was. Me driving for 3 days, not saying a word, and then arriving, and less than 2 hours later, booking a flight to fly home the next day. I remember moving into a farmhouse with friends. I remember stoned wraps until morning. I remember watching my army short hair grow slowly longer and longer. I remember blue toilet water for the first time. I remember driving heavy equipment, earth movers, until all the roads turned to gravel and began to look like bomb craters. I remember collecting unemployment until I couldn't stand showing up anymore and asking if they had work for a helicopter pilot. I remember returning to Cornell College the next fall in the theater department and watching the students stare at me. These folks were just babies. I'd only been gone from campus for 4 years, and all the students had gotten so young. And they did stare. I was the only vet on campus, and they stared at me as if I was going to pull a gun on them or do something crazy, which I usually did, just to keep them happy, you understand. I was also struck by how sloppy these kids were. Sloppy at how they lived, how they loved, sloppy at how they worked. One time, we were rehearsing William Saroyan's Time of Your Life. I played Joe. During the rehearsal, one of the students blows a line. I stare. We try the scene again. And again, he blows the line. I stare. And he starts laughing. Laughing, for Christ's sakes. Well, we try the scene one last time, and this time he blows the line on purpose. I get up, I go to him, I grab him by the shirt, and I shove him up against the wall. His feet doing that little dance that feet do when they have nothing to support. It's quiet, very quiet. And I say to him, "You do that again, and I will kill you." dropping back down. Walk back and sit. You see, he's just a kid. He doesn't know yet that life is serious. He doesn't know yet that when you make a mistake, somebody dies. He needs to know this. He needs to know this to the very bottom of his soul, or he'll never survive, that when you make a mistake, people die. And I don't want his death or the deaths that he causes on my conscience. He needs to know this. He needs to know this like Willie Akers knows this. Willie, that poor, sweet kid, made a mistake, an honest mistake. He was only trying to help, and four friends died. Willie was the nicest kid. A friendly-faced, red-haired, 19-year-old kid from Alabama. Everybody liked the guy. He was a good pilot, too. Willie flew first team lead that day. The mission was to insert our blues, or infantry, into an LZ just west of Tamkee. Now, this was a routine recon mission, searching for rice storage reported in the area. Well, Willie inserted the blues into a cold LZ and then set up his fire team of snakes overhead as air cover just in case. What happened 30 minutes later is not exactly clear, but One of the blues called, "Taken fire," and popped smoke. Willie heard the radio call, saw the smoke, and then he rolled in firing his rockets. Willie didn't know that his rockets were aimed at one of the squads of his own blues, and four men fell in the barrage before ceasefire could be called. Willie didn't know. That actor didn't know. I don't remember Willie much after that day. I know he never flew team lead again. I just can't picture Willie after that day. And I often wonder what he thought when those college kids stared at him. Did he think that they knew? Did he find a way to live with that day? The way I had to find a way to live with Mo and Pat that night in the clouds. The kids stared. Hell, I know now why they stared. When I look back at myself those first few years home, I stare too. And all during that time, I want to re-enlist. I want to go back to where I belong. 18 months after I landed in Milwaukee, my war over, and I still want to go back. Well, at night, my dreams, they took me back. I might as well go back, too. And why didn't I go back? Hey, I said I was crazy, not stupid. Oh, I could get angry. The anger of those first few missions had turned to rage. And the women who tried to reach me, each got burned. Burned by the anger, the rage, or my scorn. Or my fear. It was a pretty crazy time living in this body. Angry, afraid that someone would touch me and make me feel again. I got rid of my bank account. I spent the $11,000 blood money from Nam. I scared everybody away. BlueGhost Two-Zero couldn't get it up anymore. Proud Job had lost it all. Didn't anybody know that I didn't want to feel? And then I met some friends. I don't know how it happened. I know it didn't happen all at once. I just know that it happened. Friends. Mount Vernon, 1972. Betty, Fordyce, Bill, Maggie, Christy, Steve, Linda, Sarah, and others who would pass through this very special group, friends. This group gave back the life of Bob Drury. This group, a group who didn't care where I'd come from or what I'd done. A group that wouldn't let me scare them away because they didn't scare. Sounds serious, doesn't it? Wrong. These folks could laugh. I mean laugh at themselves, at me, at others. And when I wanted to scream and shout and drink too much, they'd just laugh and make sure I got home safely. And when I turned mean and sour and sullen, they just laughed harder. Nothing was out of character for these folks except inflicting pain on another. And if somebody wanted to go crazy, let them. They'd come back. And I did come back. Slowly. Slowly until I wanted to stay. I really wanted to stay. I didn't want to be BlueGhost Two-Zero anymore. I wanted to be Bob Drury. Oh, BlueGhost Two-Zero was still there all right at night in my dreams. But during the day, BlueGhost Two-Zero was losing his hold. What a group. A truck driver, a shopkeeper, a house painter, an actress, a bartender, a draft resister. My friend, the draft resister, and I agreed to talk to a church group, a good, liberal, understanding church group. We agreed that what we had in common was that we'd each made decisions and then acted on those decisions. He to resistance, me to war. So, we had an hour. I was to speak for 15 minutes on how I'd made my decisions, and then he would speak for 15 minutes on how he'd made his, and then I would speak for 15 minutes on how those decisions had affected me, and he the same. That morning, I was scared. He was scared. Neither one of us had talked publicly before about this personal decision stuff. We got going. My first 15 minutes went well as I explained about how I'd made some of my decisions, and his 15 minutes went well also. Then, during my second section, as I was explaining about some of the exciting things that happened to me in Nam, I noticed in the audience some heads nodding. It was the men. They were nodding. They understood, and I felt great. Well, then it hit me. They were veterans also of World War II or Korea, and they understood, and I felt great. Well, my friend finished up with a few minutes left over for questions. All the questions were for my friend. Nobody asked me anything. At the coffee, afterward, nobody spoke to me. All those veterans who nodded were in a crowd around my friend. No one talked to me. My friend had a crowd. And then one thin, slim, bald man with a snaggle smile came up to me and told me his story. All those people and one man told me his experiences during World War II. What's so incredible about his story is that he was a pacifist during World War II. That dear man who had been to jail, an asylum, and lost all his possessions because he didn't believe in war, thanked me for my story. I will remember that man and cherish that man as long friends, Mount Vernon, who let me speak and did not judge, who encouraged me to get at it. I worked in their bars, I acted in their shows, I drove their trucks, worked on their farms, and when I'd wander off, they'd welcome me back as if I'd never left. This group became the boyhood friends that I'd lost by going to Nam. This group breathed, and with each breath, I grew stronger. This group laughed and cried, and with each laugh and cry, I begun to be able to feel again. And this group played, and with the play, I lived. 2 years. And I was ready to leave Mount Vernon, try a life on my own. I had a job not too far away and a place to live. But first, I decided to unburden myself. So I loaded all my mementos, all my photos. I loaded all my poems, the ones I'd written in Nam. I loaded all my uniforms, all my mementos and memorials. I loaded boxes and boxes into my station wagon. I drove to the Lisbon dump. I paid my fee, and then I drove out as far as I could go. And I started tossing and pitching and throwing. I was ridding myself of Nam. It was sliding down this slope to be covered by tons and tons of small-town Lisbon, Iowa garbage. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye memories. Goodbye Nam, goodbye nightmares. Good riddance. It was gone and I felt great. My station wagon was empty and I was free. And off I went. It was gone. The money was gone. The poems were gone. The photos were gone. The mementos were gone. The war was gone. And off I went. I worked for a community theater. I worked for a professional theater company. I met and married my wife, Katie. We moved to Washington, D.C. I worked there. We moved back to the Midwest and started a family. I put miles and miles between Bob Drury and Nam. But even with the trip to the Lisbon dump and all those miles, Nam went with me. Until November 18th, 1985. On November 18th, 1985, I had my last Nam dream. 14 years, 10 months, and 27 days after I landed in Milwaukee. It even told me it was to be my last dream. I was in a plane, we landed, and as I was getting off the steps, there was a friend of mine from before Nam at the bottom. I got up to him and he shook my hand and he said, "Welcome home." And I shook his hand and I said, "I am never going back." That's it. That's all. I am never going back. 14 years, 10 months, and 27 days. 14 years, 10 months, and 27 nights before I allowed myself to be welcomed home. I have a new life now. One that started in Mount Vernon and continues to grow and build, a life of laughing and crying, success and failure, one probably a lot like yours. I've taken the bandages off now. The healing process has begun. Nam's memories are now those of a long-lost love affair, a mission incomplete, unfinished business. Nam's memories can no longer stand by themselves. They must now be supported by today. My son can bring back those memories. My adopted son. My son from Korea, and I love him. The son who we almost couldn't adopt because I had to decide if we were doing it out of guilt or for the desire for a child. My son. My son whose face can make me as happy as I've ever been. My son whose face looks like that soldier's that disappeared in the rocket smoke. My son can bring back the memories. Or a gun show with teenagers walking around in camouflage fatigues. Or a news story on television about U.S. troops in the Middle East or Central America or just about anywhere. Or Grenada, 17 men died capturing a college. Or Rambo, one man taking on all of Southeast Asia and winning. These can all bring back the memories. Or the wall. We simply call it the wall. Vietnam Veterans Memorial is for those who weren't there. The wall. Black granite with etchings. Black granite that stacked differently could be a bank or a courthouse, but when placed side by side in that small valley in Washington, D.C., becomes the wall. And the etchings on the face, not the names of a board of directors, but the names of the dead, the names of those who died over there. The wall, our wall, because that's where we go to remember and be sad and be angry or mourn for the boy that we left, that I left in Nam forever. The wall. My first trip to the wall. Washington, D.C., June, hot, humid, sweaty. My two boys are asleep in the back seat of the car. We are returning to a friend's house after a trip to the zoo. I see a sign, Vietnam Veterans Memorial, a parking place. There's never a parking place here along the mall. I pull over. I'll just run down and take a look. Kate and the boys stay back in the car. I'm on the sidewalk. I don't see anything. A sign pointing down the sidewalk. Walking. Another sign. A booth with a vet inside. I can't look at him. More walking. Another sign pointing to the left. Some trees. More grass. Two more booths with vets inside. I'm getting closer. My head hurts. All the blood is drained from my body to my legs. I can barely lift them. I've got the stare, the 1,000-yard stare. And the wall is there. It opens to me slowly as I round the corner. It's black. It's incredible. Tears, hundreds of tears, years of tears. To hide my tears, I go back. To hold them back, I'm back in July, and all my friends are here, and I don't have to cry because I've already cried my time. Names, names. Damn, how many names? Panels of names. And every name looks like a name I knew over there. I recognized every goddamn name on the wall. 57,000, and I recognized them all. But that can't be. Every guy in the path with sunglasses is somebody I went to flight school with. Every older woman is Mo's mom. Every kid, Pat's kid. Everyone was personal. I looked up Mo and Pat in the book. Panel 27 West, line 59. Panel 27 West, line 59. There are so many lines of names on each panel, I can't count. I can't find Mo and Pat. Panel 21 West is dark. Dark, like that night. Like that night in the clouds. And I can't see their names now as I couldn't then. I gotta go back. I gotta go back. Kate and the boys are back in the car. I gotta go back. I can't find their names. I walk back. The sun and sweat of July becomes the heat of Washington, D.C. I'm not in a flight suit anymore. I'm in tennis shoes and shorts. I see the car. My face uncurls. That was my first trip to the wall. Now, the next day, with the family, let's see. John was 4, and Ben was 1. We went to the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, as Kate called it. Well, she wasn't there. She never met the boy that I mourned for at the wall. She came later. Let's see, we spent the morning and through lunch at the museums. And then we started the walk to the wall. This time I was prepared. I spent the time watching people going to and coming from the wall. The vets were the easiest to spot. Oh, they were dressed like tourists, but more beards and sunglasses. And behind those sunglasses, the eyes, taking everything in. The ones coming from the wall were the easiest to spot. They were great to watch, trying to get themselves back to Washington, D.C., just as I'd done the day before. Now, one more thing about the vets. They didn't do the tourist stroll. You know that stroll you see at all the tourist stops, hands loosely held at the side, eyes gently roving back and forth? No. The vets walked as if under attack, carefully, but with a purpose, and the eyes taking everything in, searching for the enemy. We walked on. I talked less and less as we got closer. And then as we rounded the corner, the wall opened up to us just as it had done for me the day before. And it was then that I noticed for the first time the silence. 1,000 people, babies, toughs, tourists, grandparents, everybody from everywhere, and the only words spoken were apologies. Oh, excuse me. Pardon me. Even the cameras hesitated before they clicked, not sure they belonged. John asked why all the names were written on the wall. Kate answered, I couldn't. I had nothing to say to these folks. These folks. My family. It was like they belonged here, and I belonged here. But we didn't belong here for the same reason. We belonged here differently, separately. The wall had taken on a life of its own, and it spoke to each one of us individually. And today we came to Panel 21 West. And today I found Mo and Pat. And all those names again. And all my friends again. I took their picture, something I never did when we flew together. And I saw all those names on either side of Mo and Pat, the names of all those others that died somewhere else that night in And I saw the faces of those names. And I watched them die in firefights or jeep crashes or mortar attacks. No, Mo and Pat were not the only ones to die that night. But I couldn't go back today. I couldn't go all the way back. I had Kate and the boys. I led Kate and boys to the three figures that overlook the wall, the three bronze figures that have the right to spend the rest of their lives guarding our wall. Three figures checking out a black granite LZ. The walk back was spent watching people again. I had survived two trips to the wall, each very different, each very necessary, each a part of my new life. Each filled with Nam. Yes, I have a new life now. Very carefully carved out. Very personal. It's not the mainstream primetime kind of life I'd hoped I could fashion, no. My life couldn't be that because my country, the country that sent me off, is not ready to accept me, one of the living. It took this country 11 years to deal with the dead from Nam. It never did learn how to deal with the living. It happened in a small way that night in Vietnam. It happens every day in the country now. No. This country has never reconciled itself with us, with me. It happened in Nam. And it happens now. Now I can finish my story. Now I can tell you about that doomed Peter Pilot Mo. Now I can tell you about that night with Mo and Pat on my wing in 2-8. Late that night in the clouds. Scrambled for an emergency lerp extraction. I was lead, Pat was wing in 2-8, Mo was Pat's Peter Pilot. Two slick ships went along to pick up the recon patrol that reported taking fire. The coordinates that we were given for the recon patrol took us way out into the western mountains, and as we approached the foothills, the clouds started to close in and we had to drop altitude to stay underneath. Our ground contact, Nightfire 4, reported taking incoming automatic weapons fire and an occasional mortar. Because of the visibility, the slick ships had to stay behind while we flew down the mountain to shoot for the lerps.
Two-eight, close the end. We're going down the valley and see if we can reshoot the Nightfire. This is 2-8, roger. Nightfire, I can't bring in the pickup boats because of the weather. Maybe Wing and I can get close enough to shoot for you.
Roger, Kingsmill. I can hear your birds. Sounds like you're to our southeast.
I copy southeast. Can you follow up a scroll for a fish?
Negative,
I'll try
to pick up a scroll.
2-0, 2-8 for the clouds. Roger, 2-8. I just went in too. Begin a 90-degree turn to the left and begin to climb. I'll maintain course.
Rich, watch my gauges and let me know if I drop over 40 knots.
2-8, you copy?
Roger, left turn 90 degrees and climbing.
Nightfire, this is BlueGhost 2-0. Both thirds are in the clouds. We're gonna have to break off. Good luck. Ghost Light, this is 2-0. 2-8 and I are IFR. We'll be climbing and returning to Kehoe.
3-4, roger. We're gonna work our way back to base.
Hey, roger.
Bob, with 40 knots and dropping. Nose over.
Nose over?
Roger.
Thanks, Rich. Switch that damn beacon off. It's really screwing me up.
2-0, I'm lost. 2-0, 2-0, I'm lost.
Check your instrument. What is your heading?
I'm lost, 2-0.
Damn it, 2-8, what is your heading?
30 knots, Bob. Get it over.
Roger.
2-8, this is 2-0. What is your situation? 2-8, this is 2-0. What is your altitude? 2-8, please report your situation. 2-8, 2-8, this is BlueGhost 2-0. Please report your heading.
Ghost Light, I have negative contact with 2-8.
2-8, 2-8, this is 3-4,
please report. 2-8, this is 2-0, please report.
Ghost Light, this is 2-0. We've lost contact with 2-8. We must have gone in.
Check with the friendly, see if they saw anything. 2-8, 2-8, this is 2-0. 2-8, 2-8, this is BlueGhost 2-0. 2-8, 2-8, 2-8.
40 knots, Bob.
God damn it, roger. I'm heading east. What's our altitude?
2600 feet.
Okay, we should clear them out to 3,500 feet.
Mayday, mayday, mayday. This is BlueGhost 2-0, an AH-1G helicopter, inadvertent IFR, 26 clicks northwest of 2-I. Does anybody have me on their screen?
BlueGhost 2-0, this is Danang Radar. I copy your mayday. Please report your position.
Oh, roger, Danang. I'm climbing through 3,000 feet, somewhere northwest of 2-I. Do you have me on your screen?
Negative, 2-0.
Does anybody have me on their screen?
BlueGhost 2-0, this is Kehoe Tower. Our radar is down, we have negative contact.
Your radar is down? God damn it, does anybody have me on their screen? Can anybody tell me where the hell I am?
20 minutes later, we climbed out over the clouds and found our way back to Chu Lai. Very shaken, but happy to be back. Glad to be on the ground. I let Rich shut down the aircraft, and I walked into the briefing hut. The hut was filled with pilots. They were there to greet me. Nobody said a word. They weren't there to greet me. They were there for those other two boys. God, how selfish could I be? I came back. Selfish and guilty. Mo and Pat never did come back. Their bird was never found. I had let a brand new wingman and a doomed Peter pilot into the worst weather possible, and I wanted a welcoming home party because I survived? You're damn right I did. Because I'm back, and because thousands like me are back, and we fought our way back. For years we fought our way back, and I hate it when I see Rambo or Granada, because it cheapens war, and don't you cheapen war, because as war gets cheaper, you're more likely to spend the dime. And my sons are next. And the sons of the fathers of whatever group we call the enemy are next. And I'm not ready to go up to some poor kid at a church coffee and tell him my story because nobody'll talk to him. I'm not ready for that. Nobody should have to be ready for that! I have a new life now. I can talk about Nam now. I hug my parents every chance I get. It's not the life that was laid out for me before Nam. No, this one's a little rough around the edges. But it's a life I can share and be happy and find joy. I think and feel differently now. At least, people tell me I do.
This is 2-0. 2-8. 2-8. This is BlueGhost 2-0. 2-8. 2-8.
This is Bob.
2-8. 2-8.
This is Bob. 2-8. Mo. Pat. What's your situation? This is Bob. My name is Bob Drury. Bob is fine. You see, I have a new life now.